Well, good morning, everyone, and a warm welcome in the Saviour's name to our service of worship this morning. Whether you're in the meeting house, in the car park, or watching online, we pray that we will be blessed by our time together. We give a special welcome to the Reverend William Dickey, who we are delighted to have back in our pulpit this morning. We have been blessed by your ministry on your previous visit, sir, and look forward to hearing what the Lord has laid on your heart to share with us from his word today. Just a few short announcements. Tonight, our United Evening Service returns and will be in Trinity Congregation, when the Reverend Brian Smith will conclude a series of answers to big questions by addressing the subject, when does life begin? A very pertinent subject in light of the developments, particularly of recent days in the United States. So we would encourage as many as possible to take this opportunity to renew fellowship with our neighbouring churches in Trinity and First Ahochel tonight and in the weeks and months to come. Wednesday night, it's the midweek meeting, which will return to the Minor Hall for the first time in almost 2.5 years. Another sign of some degree of normality returning, hopefully, and an elder will take that meeting. Then an announcement from Youth Fellowship. That's an invitation for all the youth, young people of the church congregation. On Saturday, the 2nd of July, there will be a barbecue, music, games, campfire, and more at the White Rocks in Port Rush, starting at 5:30 p.m. Cars will be leaving Brookside Church car park at 4:30 p.m., and young people can be left home again at the end of the night. If you would let Liam or Richard know if you would like a lift from the church, or you can make your own way there and meet everyone at the beach from 5:30 p.m. onwards. Everyone is welcome to bring their friends along too. So it sounds like a great night. We pray that you'll be blessed with some good weather as well. Finally then, just pastoral cover. William is off duty until the 13th of July. So in the event of pastoral emergencies until the 1st of July, you're to contact the Reverend Mark Neely on the number on the announcement sheet. Then from 2nd to 12th July, cover will be provided by the Reverend Brian Smith. And again, his telephone number is on the announcement sheet. That being all the announcements, we'll hand the remainder of the service into the care of the Reverend Dickey. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Richard. And I appreciate the invitation to be back here in Brookside and to share in your time of worship. The psalmist exhorts us to bless the name of our God and King. For great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. His greatness is unsearchable. Let's worship the Lord as we come to him in prayer. Let us pray. Sovereign and ever-living Lord, incomprehensible source of all existence, before you thousands upon thousands of angels and archangels never cease to praise your holy and glorious majesty. All your works are amazing, good and glorious. You have created all things, and for your pleasure and your praise they are created. We worship you, the maker of earth and sea and everything in them. You spoke, and there they were. You commanded, and they stood forth. You said, "Let there be light," and there was light. The earth and the oceans teem with life. All creatures look to you and you give them their food in season. You are the preserver of your world, of both man and beast. Lord, you formed us from the dust, breathed into us the breath of life, fashioned us in your own image, that we might live to the praise of your glory. You have made us for immortality and everlasting joy in your presence. And Lord, although we have failed to give you the honor and the glory due to your great name, and we have often afforded you an insignificant place in our all-important lives, yet your desire to bring us to glory remains forever. Your plan, prepared from eternity, revealed through the ages, and brought to its glorious fruition in the incarnate life of your Son, is to redeem and to rescue and to restore a fallen world. He has been appointed the heir of all things. He is the radiance of the glory of the Godhead, bearing the very stamp of the nature of God. And yet, born in the weakness and the fragility of our human nature, to live a life of perfect, sinless obedience, to die a death of perfect, sacrificial atonement, to rise again in death-defying and Satan-conquering power, to make all things new, to create a new heaven and a new earth, in which righteousness and peace will reign forever. And Lord, to the end that we sinners might be co-heirs with Jesus in glory, you have sent your Spirit to convince the world of sin, of the righteousness to be had in Jesus, of the reality of judgment to come. Gracious Holy Spirit of truth, guide us into all the truth. Glorify Christ. Take what is his and declare it to us. Kindle faith in our hearts and grant us the grace of repentance and seal us until we fully possess that inheritance in Christ, and all to the praise of your glory. We pray in the name of Christ, our Savior. Amen. Now we're going to unite to sing together to God's praise the words of the hymn, Blessed Assurance.
Thank you. Let's again unite together in prayer. Let us pray. Loving Heavenly Father, we praise you today for that grace of salvation that has come to us in Jesus. We thank you, Lord, that we have that blessed assurance in him. You have given us many great and precious promises. We embrace them in faith. We pray, O God, that from day to day, our faith may become more resolute, stronger, and grounded in you, our Savior. Father, as we consider your greatness and your glory and your grace that has been extended to us in Christ, we become the more conscious of our own sinnerhood. We realize, Father, that day by day we fall far short of your glory. But we thank you that there is forgiveness with God. We thank you that your throne, whilst the throne of majesty and resplendent glory, is yet a throne of grace, where we are promised mercy. Mercy to cover all our sin, and grace to help us in every time of need. So, Lord, we know that as you have been good and gracious to us throughout our days to this present day, we know that we can trust you for all that is yet to come. Give us, Father, we pray, humble hearts. Grant to us that grace of penitence. And may we day by day avail ourselves of the grace that flows from Calvary. So we thank you for all your wonderful love for us. And as you have first loved us, we pray that we may learn to love you more for your name's sake. Amen. Now we're going to sing together the hymn, All I Once Held Dear. All this world reveres, all I once thought gain, all these things worthless compared to knowing our Savior Jesus. to come up here to the front and I'll come down to meet you. No more. Here's one or two yet. Now, this is a big throne of a thing here. I don't think I'll use that. Can I sit down here? Be all right if I sat down here? Instead, right. Good news. The Bible's all about good news. And good news is something that's for sharing, isn't it? Any of you have any good news, maybe in the past week? Anything that's been really good for you or something you want to share? Last day at school. Yeah, that's always good news. That's something I always looked forward to when I was at school, last day at school. Anything else? Anybody else? What about any tests at school or any exams? Is that good news? You do well, yeah? Right, practice papers. Uh-huh. You enjoy those? No, bad news. What about school sports? Had you school sports at the end of the year? Yeah, any winners? Yeah, okay, good news. Did you share it? Did you tell everybody? No. I don't believe you. I'm sure you were telling everybody around that you're a winner at a school sport. So good news, whatever it is something to share. And Rory McIlroy has won an Open at last, didn't he? Do you know what he did? Over a week ago, or about a week ago, the Canadian Open. Did you know that? I didn't know that until I came across it somewhere. So he did, yeah. Second time in 4 years, I think he's won that. Good news to share. Manchester United lost again. Is that good news? Or won a game, maybe that's good news. But good news is something that we always want to share. And I want to tell you about a woman. I'm sure you know about her, a woman in the scripture that actually Jesus met, and she had good news to share. You've heard of the woman from Samaria, have you? Jesus was traveling through the region of Samaria in Palestine. And he was thirsty, and he came to a well. And there's a woman who came to draw water from the well for herself. And you remember Jesus got into conversation with her, and he had a prolonged conversation. A bit of it is recorded for us in John's Gospel. And as the conversation proceeded, this woman talked about someone that she and right here, she and other Samaritans looking forward to coming into the world. And that was the Savior or the Christ. The Savior or the Christ. They were looking forward to him coming into the world. And she was talking about this and wondering where it would be and when it would be and so on. And in the course of the conversation, Jesus revealed to her and he said, "The one who's speaking to you, that was him, I am the Christ." And that was great news because the Samaritans were waiting for that for a long time, just as the Jews were. And they were waiting for the Savior who would come, the Christ or the Messiah from God. And it was such good news, of course, that she immediately left the well, left even her water carriers behind her. She went away into the town or the city where she lived to tell the people about that. And she said this, "Come and see the man who told me all I ever did. Can this be the Christ?" And they went out of the city and were coming to Jesus. And then we read this. Many Samaritans from that city believed in Jesus because of the woman's testimony, because of what she shared with them, the good news that she had to share. and they believed in Jesus. And they came to him, they asked him to stay, and he stayed there 2 days, and many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, "It's no longer because of your words we believe, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know this is indeed the Savior of the world." So that lady had met with Jesus, she had good news to share, and that's exactly what she did. She went and shared the good news about Jesus. And look at the results, look what happened. Many people, the citizens of that city, came to know and to trust and to believe in Jesus as well. And we learn about Jesus, we know about him, who he is, and what he came to do, and what he has done, and he's made that sacrifice for us on the cross. And we can share that, can't we? We can tell our friends about that, we can talk about Jesus, and we can share that good news. Many other things that are good news to us, and we share, and this is the best good news we can ever have, of Jesus, his love for us, and that he is the Savior of sinners just like us. So we're going to sing now a hymn, 10,000 Reasons. 10,000 Reasons to Bless the Lord, to Worship His Holy Name. And it says, sing like never before. So you want to do that? Everybody going to do that? Sing like never before. Bless the Lord.
Worship His holy name.
Let's turn to God's word as we find it recorded in the book of Acts and chapter 8. Acts chapter 8, and we read from the beginning of the chapter. This is following on from the testimony of Stephen, and then his death, his stoning, and how the Apostle Paul, he wasn't the Apostle then, but Saul of Tarsus, was involved in that. And on that day, a great persecution arose against the church in Jerusalem. They were all scattered throughout the region of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. Devout men buried Stephen and made great lamentation over him. But Saul was ravaging the church. Entering into house after house, he dragged off men and women and committed them to prison. Now those who were scattered went about preaching the word. Philip went down to a city of Samaria and proclaimed to them the Christ. And the multitudes with one accord gave heed to what was said by Philip when they heard him and saw the signs which he did. For unclean spirits came out of many who were possessed, crying with a loud voice, and many who were paralyzed or lame were healed. So there was much joy in that city. But there was a man named Simon who had previously practiced magic in the city and amazed the nation of Samaria, saying that he himself was somebody great. They all gave heed to him, from the least to the greatest, saying, "This man is that power of God which is called great." They gave heed to him because for a long time he had amazed them with his magic. But when they believed Philip as he preached good news about the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Even Simon himself believed, and after being baptized, he continued with Philip. And seeing signs and great miracles performed, he was amazed. Now when the apostles at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent to them Peter and John, who came down and prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit. For it had not yet fallen on any of them, but they had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then they laid their hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. Now when Simon saw that the Spirit was given through the laying on of the apostles' hands, he offered them money, saying, "Give me also this power, that anyone on whom I lay my hands may receive the Holy Spirit." But Peter said to him, "Your silver perish with you, because you thought you could obtain the gift of God with money. You have neither part nor lot in this matter, for your heart is not right before God. Repent therefore of this wickedness of yours and pray to the Lord, that if possible, the intent of your heart may be forgiven you. For I see that you are in the gall of bitterness and in the bond of iniquity." And Simon answered, "Pray for me to the Lord, that nothing of what you have said may come upon me." Now when they had testified and spoken the word of the Lord, they returned to Jerusalem, preaching the gospel to many villages of the Samaritans. Amen. And may the Spirit of God give us understanding in his word today. This book, The Acts of the Apostles, a marvelous book, tracing for us the beginning and the early history of the Christian church. The Acts of the Apostles. And of course, the apostles were greatly involved in all that happened. Some have suggested that maybe rather than calling it the Acts of the Apostles, we should call it the Acts of the Holy Spirit, or indeed the Acts of Jesus in the power of the Holy Spirit. Luke, who's the writer of this book, speaks at the beginning of his first book, the Gospel according to Luke, that he was recording all that Jesus began to do and say. And this is the continuation of it. And it's a marvelous book. Jesus had risen from the dead. After his resurrection, for 40 days, we're told that he met with his disciples, not just the inner circle, but the wider band of disciples. And for 40 days, he taught them concerning the kingdom of God. And of course, the kingdom of God was the Lord's great intent, his design to establish his kingdom, his rule and his reign, where every knee should bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And of course, that day will come. And Jesus gave to his disciples after his resurrection two promises and an exhortation. Two promises that really go together. He says, you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit. And you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And then this exhortation, you shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem, all Judea, and in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Chapter 2 of Acts records the church's baptism with the Holy Spirit and how the apostles, those men who had been hiding away, fearful from the authorities, how they were now empowered by the Spirit of God to proclaim Jesus as Lord and Christ in Jerusalem. And with amazing effect, thousands were coming to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, of course, when God moves in grace, you can be sure that Satan will rise up to stir up opposition to the gospel. Chapters 4 and 5 of Acts record the beginning of that opposition from the Jewish authorities, the Sanhedrin. They sought to silence the apostles. They then had them arrested and put in prison. And yet we are told in chapter 6 of Acts and verse 7 that the word of God increased and the number of disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem. And that a great many priests were obedient to the faith. The gospel of Jesus Christ was beginning to have an impact in the temple and in the temple worship, the source which had been the source of so much opposition to Jesus' ministry. We know that at this time the apostles, the disciples, had not broken away from the Jerusalem temple. That would come later. That would change. And the catalyst for change was a Jewish Christian called Stephen. We read about him in chapter 6 and 7 of the Acts. And Stephen appears to have understood, perhaps first amongst the disciples, that the Jewish temple worship with its sacrifices and its priesthood was now obsolete with the coming of Christ Jesus. This Jesus is the great high priest, and he has come. And he has offered the final and the ultimate sacrifice for sin, and he has opened a new and a living way to God. So that the temple worship, as it then stood, no longer fulfilled any purpose. It was part of the old covenant, the old order of things, and the new day had dawned. A new covenant had been revealed in Jesus Christ. We read, for example, in Hebrews chapter 8 and 13, in speaking of a new covenant, he treats the first as obsolete. That is, the Lord God treats the first as obsolete. And what is obsolete and growing old is ready to vanish away. If you want to read further in that, you can read Hebrews chapters 8, 9, and 10. Stephen clearly understood that his preaching of Christ, understood all of that, and his preaching of Christ reflected it. The Jewish authorities were enraged. This man is blaspheming, they said. He's speaking against the temple. He's speaking against Moses. And they fiercely reject the testimony and the teaching of Stephen. Stephen is in no doubt that their rejection of the gospel, the good news of the Messiah, is a willful disobedience to the leading of God. And we find that in, Stephen says in chapter 7, verse 51, he says, "You're a stiff-necked people, uncircumcised in heart and ears. You always resist the Holy Spirit. As your fathers did, so do you. Which of the prophets did not your fathers persecute? They killed those who announced beforehand the coming of the righteous one, whom you have now betrayed and murdered. You who received the law as delivered by angels and did not keep it." This was too much for the authorities, the religious authorities. Then church had its first martyr in Stephen. And that was only the beginning of persecution. Now in Acts chapter 8, which we read today, God continues in his pursuit of his great purpose. The commission that Jesus had given to the disciples to go and to teach all nations, beginning at Jerusalem, preaching in Jesus' name to evangelize the world, not just Jerusalem, but Judea, Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the world, to evangelize the world. In this chapter 8, Luke popularizes the Greek word euangelizo. It's a word we get from our English word evangelize, literally to bring good news. It was used once before in chapter 5, but here in this chapter 5 times. Evangelism is to engage in proclaiming good news. An evangelist is one who brings good news, and Philip is an evangelist. Indeed, in Acts 21, he's referred to as Philip the evangelist. He must have had a special gift in evangelism. And we're told here in verse 5 of Acts 8 that Philip went down to a city of Samaria and proclaimed to them the Christ. The good news is the good news of the word, as it says in verse 4, that those who were scattered went about preaching the word. Philip proclaimed to them the Christ. And in verse 12, he preached good news about the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ. The good news is the good news of the word. It's the good news of the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, the good news of Jesus. And there's something very important in these verses that we read today that I want to share with you again. They're simple, but they're very significant. And the first is this, the content of the gospel. What is the gospel? The good news. There can be no evangelism without the evangel, that is, the good news message. No evangelism without the gospel. And the gospel is the good news of Jesus. The church's task is evangelism. You shall be my witnesses, says Jesus, to evangelize the world. Jesus is that good news. That is, Jesus in his incarnation, the Son of God who takes flesh to dwell amongst us. Jesus in his life. My food, he says, is to do the will of him that sent me. Jesus in his death. I have come not to be served, but to serve and give my life a ransom for many. Jesus in his resurrection, who presented himself to the apostles and others alive after his passion by many proofs and over those 40 days. Jesus in his ascension, he's at the Father's right hand. He's exercising kingdom authority and kingdom rule. Jesus in his promised return in glory. This Jesus will come again in the same way as you saw him go into heaven, said the angel. This Jesus is the evangel. This is the gospel. This is the good news. Jesus in his birth, in his life, in his death, his resurrection, his ascension to glory, and his return in glory. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 4 and 5, "For what we preach is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord." Jesus, the sum and the substance of the gospel. We must never lose sight of that. He is the content of our preaching of the gospel. If Christ ceases to be the message that we proclaim, Christ in his eternity, Christ in the flesh, Christ in his obedience, Christ in the atonement, Christ in his glory, Christ in his coming again, if that ceases to be our proclamation, it's no longer gospel. It's no longer evangel. And the message that we proclaim and declare, however eloquent, however relevant, however arresting it is robbed of its content and robbed of its power. The gospel is the power of God to salvation, not the eloquence of the preacher or the ability of the evangelist, but the gospel is the power of God to salvation to everyone who believes, and that gospel is Christ. And so we read in verse 5 here of Acts chapter 8 that Philip, the evangelist, proclaimed to them the Christ. And we are told that the Samaritans believed to the salvation of their souls. We read later on how Philip is to meet an Ethiopian on the road to Gaza, and we are told that he expounds the Old Testament scriptures of Isaiah that the Ethiopian was reading and didn't understand. And Philip expounded the scriptures to him by declaring to him, we are told, verse 35 of this chapter, by declaring to him the good news of Jesus. So Jesus was a content even of Isaiah, the prophecy of Isaiah. And nothing has changed in 2 millennia as regards the gospel. Let's never imagine that the plain gospel of the crucified and risen Savior has somehow, with the passage of time, gone past its sell-by date. The modern quest for innovation, for novelty, for connection and for relevance and so on must never be allowed to obscure the never-changing gospel. Yes, we need to connect with people. We need to be relevant to the world in which we live. There is place, certainly, at times for innovation, but it must never obscure the never-changing gospel of the kingdom of God, verse 12 here, the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ. And by name, it means all that Jesus is and all that he has done. So that's the first thing. The content of the gospel. Secondly, just as we must never lose sight of the content of the gospel, neither ought we to abandon the primary method of evangelism. And we find that stated very clearly here in verse 5. Philip went down to the city of Samaria and he proclaimed to them. Verse 12, that is, he preached good news about the kingdom of God in the name of Jesus Christ. Verse 25, they went about preaching the gospel to many villages of the Samaritans. And verse 35, Philip opened his mouth, beginning with the scriptures. He told, proclaimed, preached the good news of Jesus Christ. And so on. We should never despise or abandon the preaching of the gospel. The preaching of the gospel. God has given us his word to be preached. That's the very reason that God has given us his word, in order that it be proclaimed, that it be declared, that it be preached. The gospel is for preaching. Christ is to be preached. Now, we live in an age when the scriptures are despised, and God's word is written off as outdated and irrelevant, a relic of history. And it's not just the likes of the new atheists, Richard Dawkins and others, or the liberal critics in the academic world who are guilty of that, but often the professing Christian or the church member who rarely reads the scripture or seldom applies its truth and its teaching to daily life is just as guilty of despising the Word of God and the content of the Word, which is Christ. How the preaching of the Word is downgraded today. It may be endured, may be accorded a place, but whatever, don't let it run over 20 minutes at any one time. I've heard the old mantra time and time again. If you can't say what needs saying in 15 minutes, it's not worth saying. What nonsense that is. Dr. Kidd, the famous Dr. Kidd of Aberdeen, he was born in Bershain. He was raised early years in Bershain. He eventually went to study in America and returned to Scotland, took up a charge in Gilcomston Church in Aberdeen, eventually became a professor in the college. But in Gilcomston was used to three Sunday services. In the morning, the Old Testament was expounded. In the afternoon, the Gospels were preached, and in the evening, the epistles were preached. Dr. Kidd preached at those three services. There were 2,000 people at each service. Possibly many of them were the same at each service. And his sermons, we're told, usually never exceeded an hour and a half. Don't know if you want to pass it on to William Moody or not, but it's not the sort of thing that we necessarily want to follow. But people were hungry for the word. They wanted to hear the gospel. The gospel was proclaimed, and there was no such thing as reducing it to a few minutes homily. Some will say, well, aren't there other ways, more acceptable, more effective, more endurable, more innovative than preaching? Preaching's a turnoff. It just doesn't connect anymore. One Sunday when I was leaving the pulpit, went down to one of the doors of my church in Bershain, and a lady came, and I think she refused to shake my hand, but she looked at me with a look that would melt iron. And she said, well, that was some marathon. There's another lady in the congregation who was in her 80s, came to church with a walking aid, one of those three-wheel jobs. And she said to me, why did you stop so soon? She said, I could have listened for another half hour to the sermon this morning. It's going to depend on our attitude and how we come, how we prepare our hearts to hear the word of God. Of course, there are many ways of disseminating the gospel. Of course, there are. And there are times and situations where those things are demanded, maybe rather than the preaching. But Paul's words to Timothy have never lost their application. In his second letter to Timothy and chapter 4, in the first verses of that chapter, Paul says to Timothy, I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing and his kingdom, preach the word, be urgent in season and out of season, convince, rebuke, and exhort, be on feeling in patience and in sound teaching. The time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but have itching ears that will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own liking, will turn away from listening to the truth and wander into myths. As for you, always be steady, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry. Those words are as pertinent today as ever they were. Jesus' commission was to go to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem, and to all the world, he said, and preach in his name. There's the method, to preach in his name. That's the content, to preach who Jesus is. Now, just a third and final thing. Isn't it interesting how the church was enabled to carry out Jesus' commission? Acts chapter 8, verses 1-4. On that day, a great persecution arose against the church in Jerusalem. They were all scattered throughout the region of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. Devout men buried Stephen and made great lamentation over him. But Saul was ravaging the church and entering house after house. He dragged off men and women and committed them to prison. You remember that record earlier on, the Acts of the Apostles in chapter 2, how the disciples, after the resurrection of Jesus and the giving of the Spirit and so on, they were gathered together. They were gathered together and they were sharing in the meal, and they had all things in common, and they were giving themselves to the teaching of the apostles and to prayer and the breaking of bread. Wasn't that marvelous? And wouldn't it have been wonderful just to have continued in that happy, that loving, caring, comfortable environment, enjoying the teaching of the apostles, the fellowship, the breaking of bread, and the prayers. But the Lord had other ideas. He was pursuing that plan of salvation to the nations. We remember the covenant with Abraham, Genesis, how that he would be a blessing and his seed would be a blessing to the nations. And of course, the seed ultimately was Jesus, would be a blessing to the nations. How in Isaiah, in those great chapters of the servant of the Lord, that he was given, it said, as a light to the nations. Remember the song of Simeon in Luke chapter 2, when he cradled the child in his arms and he says, "My eyes have seen the salvation of the Lord, a light for revelation to the Gentiles, for glory to the people Israel." Revelation to the nations. Jesus, "I am the light of the world. Go make disciples of all nations." The vision of John in the book of Revelation, chapter 7, was something that would come, was already in God's blueprint. In Revelation chapter 7. Revelation 7, verses 9 and 10, John says, "After this I looked, and behold, a great multitude which no man could number, from every nation, from all tribes, peoples, and tongues, standing before the throne, before the Lamb, clothed in white robes with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, 'Salvation belongs to our God who sits upon the throne and to the Lamb.' And the angels stood round the throne and round the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshipped God, saying, 'Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen.'" And so in Acts chapter 8 and verse 1, on that day a great persecution arose. It broke like a storm. No doubt the storm had been gathering for some time, but it broke like a storm through Saul the Pharisee. Saul was ravaging, he was devastating the church. The word that's used expresses a brutality, a sadistic cruelty. He was breathing out threats and murders, we are told. Later on, after his conversion and his testimony before the Sanhedrin, he said, "I persecuted this way to the death." And before King Agrippa, he said, "I condemned believers to death." Where was God in this? Where where was God in all of this? The persecution, the scattering, and so on. Well, God was right there at the helm. He was right there in the eye of the storm. He was pursuing his purpose. He was accommodating the church in her mission. How is this accommodating the church? Well, we're told they were all scattered, and those who were scattered went about preaching the word, preaching Christ. First, they were gathered in Jerusalem and devoting themselves to the teaching and to the prayers, and then they were scattered. Having been taught, they are scattered. God moves in a mysterious way, his wonders to perform. He plants his footsteps in the sea and he rides upon the storm. Persecution. That's the devil's work. Scattering, I think that's God's work. For evangelism. So who's in control? Well, the risen Lord is in control. You shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the earth. He's in control. That's what he said. And Philip went down to a city of Samaria, and he proclaimed to them the Christ. You see how God is unwrapping his purposes. Nothing's going to frustrate his plans. It was a Pharisee called Gamaliel, famous Pharisee and teacher and rabbi of that day. And it was Gamaliel of the Sanhedrin, the Jewish council. He was absolutely right in what he had said. In chapter 5 and verse 33, they were enraged. They wanted to kill the disciples. But a Pharisee in the council named Gamaliel, teacher of the law, held in honor by all the people, stood up, ordered the men to be put outside for a while. That's the disciples. And he said to them, men of Israel, that is, he said to the council, the Jewish council, men of Israel, take care what you do to these men, for before these days, Thaddeus arose, giving himself out to be somebody, and a number of men, about 400, joined him. But he was slain, and all who followed him were dispersed and came to nothing. After him, Judas the Galilean arose in the days of the census, and drew away some of the people after him. He also perished, and all who followed him were scattered. So in the present case, I tell you, keep away from these men. Let them alone. For if this plan or this undertaking is of men, it will fail, just as it had with Thaddeus and with Judas. But if it is of God, said Gamaliel, you will not be able to overthrow them. You might even be found opposing God. And how right he was. He may not have known it himself, but he was right in what he was saying. The Lord still pursues his purposes. And he calls us, the church today, the church together wherever it's found, individual believers like us within God's church, he calls us to get on board with him, to go, to make disciples, to share the good news, to preach the word in season and out of season, in whatever fashion, whatever place, in whatever way God calls us to do that. We may not be called away into another part of the world. We may not be called into full-time ministry of the gospel, but we're all called as the children of God, as believers in Christ, to share that good news. And who knows what God may do for the good news, however we present it, however we share it, sometimes maybe in trembling. Sometimes our faith is small, but however we do it, it is the power of God. It's not our eloquence, not our ability, not our gifts, but it is the power of God to salvation, to everyone who hears and who believes. Let us rise to sing together to God's praise. This hymn of encouragement for us, Church of God, elect and glorious. Christ, and the love of God our Father, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.